Okay, welcome to this Tuesday, January the 19th, Organic News here on Awake Radio. I'm actually going to skip the music intro because one of our guests is limited for time. We have Danette Chavis of National Accountability for Police Brutality. Did I get that right, Danette?
Actually, it's National Action Against Police Brutality and Murder.
Okay. We also have Julio Pabon, who is running for city council in the Bronx, Shannon Jones of Y Accountability, and Agnes Johnson of New Yorkers Against Bill Bratton. But we're going to start with Danette first because she has to leave in less than 30 minutes. So we were out all yesterday in the freezing cold at the Supreme Court in the Bronx for Martin Luther. And what exactly was the point of the gathering?
Yeah, well, that was an event that was called by Nene Ali. She's a young woman, hip-hop artist, advocate for the youth, and she felt that Martin Luther King's birthday was a great day to launch an initiative that she's trying to put forth for the youth, to reach out to the youth in an attempt to come up with concrete solutions, you know, that face us all. So it was basically, you know, supposed to be the start of an initiative with further subsequent action behind it.
And, a whole lot of people showed up. It was actually really, really freezing out. So talk about what it is that you do with being against police brutality. What happened to you? You've been on this show before, actually, with Frank Serpico last year.
Yeah. Well, actually, I lost a child at the hands of police. And my case is different from the majority of mothers out here because their children were directly fired upon by police, but my situation was different in that police failed to give him the medical attention that was needed.
Hold on. So, sorry. Mm-hmm. Someone is calling in the Randy Short. Oh. Hello?
Yes, I'm trying to reach Sister Agnes Johnson.
Oh, did you have a question?
I had a suggestion.
Would you mind actually calling back at 6:30 after the first guest is?
I didn't, you know, I just got a message from Agnes that said starting at 6. That's why I called a little after 6. You want me to call you back?
Or you're welcome to stay on and listen to the first guest and then we'll bring Agnes in.
Is that a relative
of the Garner family?
Are you
Randy Short? Randy, why don't you just text me? I'm going to be on in half an hour.
Okay, well, no, I wanted to hear the program, but as well make a suggestion since you sent me the invitation. So I can listen. That's fine with me.
Okay, go ahead, Danette.
Okay, I was talking about the loss of my son at the hands of police. And how the case was different. My case was a negligence case. There's a law that when you come into the custody of police, that they're required to get you medical attention. And their failure to do so resulted in a lawsuit for negligence. Where my son was an innocent victim of a crossfire shooting, and he got hit. But where he was when he was hit by the bullet was like 2 blocks from Lincoln Hospital in the Bronx. And his friend got as far as a block before the hospital when the police pulled up, drew their weapons, told them to put him down, which they initially refused because the hospital was right there. But they told them to put him down upon threat of shooting him. So when they did, they were put in a patrol car, and the police didn't call an ambulance. According to the people in the area, the ambulance never came. The police say that they did call an ambulance. But anyway, a lawsuit was filed in federal court, and the judge felt that the actions of the police had to be so egregious as to shock the conscience. So that lawsuit didn't go anywhere. And the attorneys that I had, because it was drawn out for 7 years of postponements, adjournments, when it was decided against us, the attorneys didn't want to pursue it to the Supreme Court because I couldn't afford to pay them, basically. That's what it came down to. They didn't want to spend any more money in pursuing a case because they took my case, first of all, on a contingency basis because they were sure that they would win it. And when that didn't happen, that was the end of that. So anyway, throughout that 7 year period while the case was in trial, I was going to a lot of rallies and protests and meeting all of these families who lost their loved ones, I believe, and I was seeing the same results, you know, denials for justice. It didn't matter, you know, the witness, it didn't matter, the evidence, it just plain out and out didn't matter. And it got to the point, to me, after a while, where it was just absurd to keep doing this over and over. I felt that with all the things that was being demanded and recommended, I felt that at the root cause of all the murders and police getting away with it was a lack of accountability. So I thought of this, why don't we just deal with this one shot, get it right across the board, since there were so many, you know, people dying like this. And I fully expected that the organizations that I had become in contact with throughout that period, that they would readily accept the idea, grab the idea, and help push it forward, but that was not the situation. So it came to a point where I just literally took a leap of faith, and I just put it out there myself. I started with a petition, you know, outlined the reasons why, and I just pushed it as much as I could here and there in an attempt to get signatures while I was out there, you know, supporting families and helping them in their fight for justice. And it turned into a situation where people started asking me for aid, asking me for assistance, you know, wanting me to come to their city. You know, it's like it appeared to them that I'm an organization. I am not. You know, I'm a person with a grassroots organization, a person who's trying to hopefully develop a grassroots organization so that we can deal with the issue of police brutality and murder head on. There's a lot of things that I would like to do, step to, and address to, but resources do not allow me to do those things. So basically, for the last several years, we've been pushing and pushing the demand for police accountability across the United States. Last year, this time, myself and nine mothers, we went as a delegation to Washington, D.C. We went to the Department of Justice, spoke to the top officials there. We spoke at Congress. You know, we met with staff of the Obama administration, and I tested it while I was there. I put before those people at the Department of Justice the basis and the premises that I was pushing this demand, and they could not answer me. So I knew then that I was right. Yeah. So, and I told the people this when I came back, even before I went. I think we had like 18,000 signatures. And I was like, just give me 50. I will work with 50,000. But it's, you know, it's different people. It's like when people don't really know you or you're not really out there, it's like they really, I guess, they don't know the extent that you're really willing to push something or make something happen. So, but anyway, I'm still dealing with this issue. For me, there's no place else to go. Okay, there's no place else to go whatsoever. You know, I don't put any kind of emphasis on special prosecutors or cameras. I do think that officers should wear cameras, but I think that the wearing of cameras does not help us get justice. All it does to me is give you a front row seat to the crime. Right. That's what it does. But you still have to deal with the same demons and the same animals that have been denying justice all along. You know, the remedies that have been proposed over the years in an attempt to get justice, they do not deal with the issue of accountability. For me, that's the bottom line. Until an officer's ass is on the line and he knows that he's going to jail or and lose his job or both, it's not happening. And the issue with police, it's like I was saying for years, you cannot deal with this issue down in the valley only. You have to take it to the top because the things that are happening down in the valley, like where we are, they are emanating from the top.
So when you're talking about what an officer did wrong, okay, that officer, whether you know it or not, is following the directions and the training that he's being given. He's not going to be punished for that. Okay, the behavior and the things that he's doing, believe it or not, is acceptable. Okay, there are people higher up that they make a life, a living wage. They live off of the fact that people can be incarcerated, live off of the fact that people are being jailed. It's deeper than what we think it is.
Right.
You know, and it must be dealt with at the very top of the government. And if you don't understand that, then you should look at how we have a mass incarceration problem here in the United States, 2.3 million people in jail throughout the United States. When private industry can enter into contract with your government and tell them that you must guarantee us a 90% full to capacity population within the prison, or else we're not going to sign the deal with you. Baby, if you don't understand what time it is when you hear that, I don't know what else to tell you. Okay, it's in the government's interest to maintain a system of incarceration, particularly when they enter into contracts like that with private industry, okay, who is allowed to use these men for free labor. Okay, the police department is a tool by which they go and scoop them off the street. So here you are as a parent talking about what they did to your child. Trust, they ain't thinking about you and your child. They thinking about their money. Okay, and they intend to keep that and make some more. So until we get to that level of understanding, it's, you know what, it is what it is.
The public, I don't think, really understands that fact, that things are that bad. I mean, I'm always, every time I do a post, a YouTube video, or write an article on Hot Indie News or Democracy Chronicles, I'm always tagging Correctional Corporation of America.
Mm-hmm.
So that,
well, listen,
so that people,
I'll go so far as to say, you know, it is deliberate and intended that people stay in that mindset where they cannot see what's going on. I think it's deliberate that people are being filled with consumerism, materialism, and that people are made to continually be on the chase for things, you know, to look like, feel like, all this other nonsensical stuff that keeps them in the darkness concerning the reality that we are currently living in. Okay, and even that, they are profiting off of. Capitalism is profiting. Everywhere you look, money is being made. It's like that is the bottom line. As long as the capitalist society, government can keep people deaf, dumb, and blind, the longer they can keep making money. And if the intent is to destroy you, they even make money off of that. Any which way you go, it's money is being made. And this system is dependent upon people being deaf, dumb, and blind. People not being able to see the forest for the trees. People thinking the problem is on the left when it's really on the right. Okay? It must maintain a course like that in order for its continuance. But when it's exposed and it's revealed and people can see, oh, hello, now he's playing a new game.
I mean, it's getting really bad if we're to the point where, I mean, it's so clear that everything is about money, the justice system, and everything is about money. I was gonna ask you, what faith do you have in voting? You know, now that Obama's on his way out, and do you have any plans on voting? And if you do, do any of the candidates, do you have any faith in any of them?
You know, that's like a trick question. You know, because change must occur. And people will tell you that the way in order you go about getting change is that you must be a part of the process. You might not like the process. You may not agree with the process. But right now, in this day and this time, that's how things are done, allegedly. To a certain degree, that is true. But in a larger picture, that is not true. On the lower level, you may be able to galvanize enough people to support around you and actually get you into office. Okay, but higher up in government, it's about money. It's about funding a candidate to make sure that he gets in office so that he can sign new laws and legislation to keep these rich capitalist people making money. You understand? It's about capitalism. Okay, these people who are elected into office, you might as well call them the CEO of whatever entity it is they're representing, because they no longer represent the people. That changed a long time ago. I don't understand how people can have a confidence or a belief in an election process where you saw during the Bush years, okay, you saw the theft of a presidency. That's what you saw. Okay, and then you saw when it came for the next round, when everybody came out the woodworks and voted, vote or die, rock the vote. Yes, they rocked it, and you still got in office. Okay, that should tell you something right there. You know, black people have been, people of color, have been suffering oppression coming and going left and right, and all of a sudden a black man is elected, you think, into office? And then even when you see that your situation has gotten worse than it's ever been before, you still holding on to dear life.
Yeah.
Okay? True indeed. Half of the stuff that's being said about Obama, half of the white folks would have said it if Obama would have did a wonderful, great job. Because a good part of America is mad because the man is black. Okay, point blank. Whatever he does, right, wrong, and different, if they're racist, they don't like him, they ain't gonna like him. But there's things that Obama has done right in line with the previous administration before him. You can't excuse that. And my issue with Obama is, if you say, I'm not the black president, I'm the president of America, then what the hell did you think the entire world stood up and was giving you an applause for? What the hell did you think you were getting a Nobel Peace Prize for? He was the only individual who got a Nobel Peace Prize before he ever did one damn thing. Okay? He got a Nobel Peace Prize before he signed one piece of legislation in office. And if it wasn't because you was a black man, the first black man in office, what the hell was it? So how can you accept all that praise, all that adulation, and the Nobel Peace Prize itself, then turn around and tell people, well, I'm not the black president, I'm the president of all. You should have told them, thank you for your Nobel Prize, but no thank you. Okay, if that's how you felt, but he didn't do that.
Right. I mean, these never-ending wars, I mean, that's another topic of discussion that, you know, we could talk about for, for hours, I'm sure.
Yes.
Again,
it's all the same. Wars make money. Okay,
right.
plenty money. You know, during the Bush administration, the vice president owned Halliburton. Halliburton is a company that created the weapons for the war. So who you think got paid during those years of invasions over there?
Yeah.
He did. Okay, you want to talk about gangsters? Listen, you don't know nothing about being no gangsters. You need to look at the 8 years of Bush and what the hell they did when they was in office. Those was the gangsters. Okay, stole the presidency. They said, yeah, we did that. Go and do it again. Next 4 years come around and get it.
Right. So, okay, like, what are you working on now, Danette? Like, what is your, like, you're still trying to get justice?
Same thing. I'm not moving from where I'm at, because you know what? When I'm out there, I'm talking to the people. When I'm on Facebook, I'm writing to the people. Either you hearing what I'm saying or you not. School's out. Those who got it, run with it. Let the rest play catch up. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, we really need, everything has to be a grassroots movement, because I don't have any faith in voting. I don't think that anybody who gets to be president, you know, as good as their intentions might be, you know, the corporations own the White House and everything. And
here's the thing. We can say that, and we can be as right as rain. Okay, we can say it's a fraud, we can say it's about money, and all of that can be true. But right now, in this hour, the functioning of things and how you get things, it's still that system. It's still that system. Okay, we're in the trick. It's either you want to go with the process as it is and be a participant with all this flaws and all this BS, or you want to totally kick all of that to the side. Now, how can you and you alone do that? You can't. How can you even get 50 or 100 other servicers that feel like you, believe like you, and gonna move when you move? Can you? Can you? So this is where we're at. There's people out here that they know what time it is. They've been there, they've done that, you know, because the game ain't changed. It's just, they just up the ante, okay? But everything that's been, that needs to be said has been said. You know, this generation, you know, we ain't saying that new and trick that Amber said back in the 60s. We weren't paying attention. And we don't even bother to take the time to go back and look and see what it was. Aside from that shit they tell us like Martin Luther King and keep us focused on a goddamn dream.
Yeah.
Okay? Read it for yourself. We ain't doing that. Because we stuck in consumerism. Yeah. And we want what we want. Okay? Everybody want to look like they got it going on. Life is lovely. Yeah, they look this and that. Good. That's right where they want you.
What do you want to tell the people?
Sign my petition. Sign my petition. Give me them signatures.
Where do they find?
Give me them signatures.
Yeah, where's your petition? Tell them where it is.
It's on change.org. It's also on Facebook. I have a page on Facebook that's devoted entirely to National Action Against Police Brutality. I make my own videos. I post videos showing the murders and brutality so that people can get a front row seat and see it for themselves. Because it took a long time for people to believe that cops was actually killing people in cold blood. Yes, even handcuffed too. So I started posting these things so they could see it, you know, and understand. The need is bigger than what you think.
Oh.
It's deeper than what you think. You know, it's deeper than, you know, a mother lost a child here, there. It's deeper than all of that is important and included, but it's deeper than that. This, what's going on here in America, is going to affect America, in fact, the entire world. Okay? It's deeper than what we think it is. We tiptoeing through two little dealing with this little issue over here and that little issue. What's going on right now has worldwide effect. You have to look at the unification that's coming along within the judicial system globally, with the banks globally, you know, things that are happening worldwide where entities are aligning themselves together. Okay, you have to look at that. You have to pay attention to those things. You have to ask yourself what is going on. But you can't, because that's out of your scope and your range of stuff that you're concerned with, because this country, who owns the media, directs your thoughts, directs where your attention flows, and so directs where your energy flows. You have to literally come out of this shit if you want to see clearly. But how many are going to do that? How many have been given a reason? Most parents in this fight have done that because when you lose a loved one, your whole mind just got rocked. And when you try to go and get justice and you find out that fairy tale story don't exist, oh yeah, you be on a search for truth for real. Because you recognize this, the shit you've been told was wrong. And you search for answers, real answers, shit like that cause you to go deep, deep within your own self to find out what's true and what's not. I hate for the entire world at one time to have that type of experience, because at that point, I think it would be too late for us to do what we need to do. I'm trying to get people to wake up and let's do this now.
Yeah, it's unfortunate that it really has to hit people directly. And I mean, I think it is hitting people directly. It's just not, they're just not feeling it because it's happening slowly and gradually, which is, you know what, it's, that's the problem.
Which is a shame. And on that note, I'm going to get off this phone and let you go on with your other guests.
So it's National Action Against Police Brutality is your petition.
Yes.
And also change.org.
Right. And they can visit our page on Facebook.
Okay.
Also.
Thank you so much, Danette Chavis.
All right. Good night.
Okay. Thank you so much. So, does anybody mind if Agnes goes next, seeing is that she's got a question, a caller waiting? Is that okay with Shannon and Julio?
Just fine. I'm hanging in.
Okay.
I'm ready for Mother Agnes.
Okay, so the next guest is going to be Agnes Johnson of New Yorkers Against Bratton, but that's just one of the hats that you wear, Agnes. Tell us about the others.
Well, I'm a closet full, so it depends what chapter I'm in. I'm glad Randy Short is on. He's not only a journalist, but a great, great fighter for human rights. And I'm glad he called in. I don't know what he's giving me some advice I need to know. But we have all been talked out. I mean, everything that needed to be said has been said. And at this point in time, some people are just terrified, literally terrified of being called upon to do something, to put their body on the mat, on the front line. So right now, all the smoke is clearing. I mean, the Obama time, it's all done. We were told to shut up when Obama was running. We were told to shut up. That we don't know what we're talking about, and we can't ask these questions because we won't get in if we ask these questions. And then when the term came, oh, just wait for the second term. Well, now we're at the end. We're at the end. And now we see that it does not trickle down. And if it did trickle down a penny or two, it's done now. It's gone. And right now, what's happening is everything is imploding. Everything. And all the so-called reform, reorganization, integration, all of that. It's gone. It's gone. And there's nowhere else to go. And the trick bags that we are in are either to follow these fake ministers, follow these fake politicians, or fight. And the point is, institutional racism has interfered with every fiber of the community, of the black and brown, and now it's even the Asians in Chinatown. There is no more, there's just no more to beg for. There's no more to request. It's either you're going to fight for it, because they are not going to give it up now.
Right.
And they are so terrified of our ability to organize and to push back. That's why there is zero tolerance now. What in their right mind, what person has ever raised a child, would ever say to a child, "We have zero tolerance"?
Yeah,
it's,
but zero tolerance
it's zero tolerance. How can you have zero tolerance? It's not even manageable to have such a thought. It's ridiculous.
I mean, it's amazing. Like, they have zero tolerance for, you know, normal behavior. They criminalize even normal behavior of the, you know, the average person. But meanwhile, they have all the tolerance, in the world for the criminality of the bankers and the corporations that are literally destroying the planet.
Exactly. So, but to tell us, our children, where we live, where we work, there's going to be zero tolerance on you. But again, that's not even manageable, because that does not show any kind of logical thinking. There's no way. But what's happening, like I say, is somebody created this mess. Somebody created unequal rule. Somebody created all this. And now they're telling us, no, you're wrong. Everything's good. You're just not doing this. Or you're just not wearing your pants right. Or you're just not in the right school. Or you just didn't. I mean, I had someone tell me today, and I've been through theater for over 40 years in theater. I was graduate of high school before the arts. I went all the way to the top. I traveled the world. I taught in schools. Forever. I mean, I've walked with great people, such as Lynn Stewart, Dr. Ben. I mean, you name it, on all facets of the spectrum. I've protested the Vietnam War as well as days before shock and awe in San Francisco. I've been around the world. I've come to New York, and the first thing I see is the schools are failing. Well, why are the schools failing? Well, it's all the children's fault. Well, how is it the children's fault? Well, they're not passing the test. What You know, and so it trickles down until it's just their fault. So either accept it. But then I moved into a community in Harlem. And we saw the wagons coming in. And we warned everyone. We joined these organizations. We had hands across 125th Street from river to river. And yet, the politicians went in that city hall and they voted against the people. And that's what I saw. Only two people voted against the rezoning or the selling of Harlem, and that was Tony Aiello in Queens and Charles Barron. Only those two. And the city hall, what's her name? I mean, Dickens and Robert Jackson kicked us out of the balcony so they could have that vote. And at that point, I realized it doesn't matter about electing a black official. It doesn't matter.
Right.
So it's all about their careerism. There is no governmental official in the New York City Council other than maybe one or two. Again, Agnes Barron. So they'll always be outvoted. We saw Charles Barron last week stand up to Cuomo in Albany. Again, outvoted.
I love how they blame the people. I mean, or they blame the kids. That's what I'm saying. Like they pass. That's how they pass the debt down. I mean, how can you blame children? I mean, that's ridiculous. It's the people in charge
not children. We know as teachers, as educators, anyone in child psychology knows that punishment is not what makes us good. We know this. I lived in a super rich community in Davis, California. Everybody had 3 and 4 degrees. Oh my goodness, the schools were outstanding. They only had 2 high schools, and both of them every year vied for the top grade of the whole school, 99.8%, next year, 99.9%. And it was not about our children. Now, white children were treated very gently, and the few black children were there still could not achieve the greatness that they had. I was there and witnessed a black youth who became Davis High School Editor of the Year, Student of the Year. He was winning scholarships, and death threats were made against him. Now what do they get from that, you wonder? And that mother had to take her child out of the school before the end of his senior year, so he didn't have prom, he didn't have graduation, to save his life. And to compensate him, the school district gave him early entry into UCD with everything paid. And that mother said to me, when I move my son out of here, I close this book forever. And that's what we do. Every time we get these wounds, we close the book forever for our child. Instead of saying, no, we have to do it for all of our children. I moved to here in the Bronx, and I was shocked at all the things that were laid at the feet of disconnected young people, expecting them to solve things on their own.
Right.
They need to be persevering. They need to be optimistic. What do you feed them to give them that?
Well, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, they're doing everything backwards. It's like they're supposed to be the leaders. They're supposed to be the ones instilling, you know, in children, you know, giving them something to be inspired about. You know, like,
that's not the plan. And that's what I've come to decide. It is not the plan for the growth and development of our children. Just as in Davis, California.
Yeah, it's a joke.
It is not a fair play. They do not want our children to compete with their children for the pieces of the pie. Now, when I came to here in the Bronx, the first thing I did, I said, you never have a Kwanzaa. So I did a Kwanzaa. I invited your officials and everybody. They didn't have a Kwanzaa. They're starting an arts program. They didn't have any dance. They didn't have any theater. No way up and down the block. But they also did not want to help me. And that's where I was like, I found strange. The more we achieved, and the children that were in the theater class started to excel in school, their parents started seeing it, their parents started coming, we started taking them on trips, the more the school and the officials pulled the ropes from them. And I didn't understand that mentality.
And then turn around and still blame the kid or the parent.
Well, the thing was, They didn't like it because these parents started to organize.
Exactly.
They started to actually take their children out of the school. The other thing that we saw within these poor communities, and these are high incarceration neighborhoods, right? And at the same time, they're pouring, you know, they have three failing elementary schools, so there's no way for the children to miss going into a failing elementary school. At the same time, they're dumping shelters. And that was, who was to do that? Dumping of shelters. In Highbridge, they had the most amount of shelters, 18 homeless shelters in the city.
Yeah.
And then I looked at Riverdale, none. I looked at another place, Morris Park, none. In Highbridge and Morris Avenue, 18.
Agnes, talk about the buses and what's going on with the police arresting the people where you live in the Bronx, and what is it called, Highbridge?
That's a plan of action. That's definitely a ramped up plan of action. And as Danette was saying, you know, all of this has been going on. We've been fighting stop and frisk and the killing of our people, our children, and now our elders even. Well, I don't know how long, but the carte blanche has been given to Bratton, and it's been given to him by these politicians that are supposed to be representing us. So now he is using, not stop and frisk, now he's calling the broken windows, to prevent crime before it escalates. Because these communities are just escalating and percolating with criminals. So they're coming onto the buses that do not have adequate service, where people can't get on a bus because they're so crowded by the time the bus comes. And so people with unlimited or children with bus passes, because they're going and coming from school, will go through the back door just to get on a bus and to get home or wherever to work.
And the bus driver,
coming on undercover and giving $100 ticket. Now, I've witnessed them do it to three elderly women. Two of them, they had actually, the undercover cop held the door open for the elderly person to go in with her and limited, sit down, and then they pull her off with a ticket. The thing I said to you today, which people are very scared about, the police are going into Harlem Hospital and pulling poor people, elderly also, sitting on those chairs and making them get out. In the subway, we see the same thing. So no matter where we travel, it's almost like if we don't have our freedom papers, if we are runaway slaves, they are there to catch us. But not like one or two, they come as five. And so I watch them come to the bus stop here at Yankee Stadium. Five of them standing undercover clothes, not even in their blues, in undercover hoodies and things, trying to fit in, filming us, and then waiting, looking for somebody to go through that back door. So I've been taking over the bus. I've been handing out flyers. But the thing that's amazing is, even yesterday, coming to the event, when I took over the bus, and I said, I'm going to this event, and I'm speaking about what's going on this bus line to us. You know, the entire bus lit up. So many men said, I've gotten that ticket. They gave me, even though I told them, I have a transfer. I have an unlimited. And they, what did the cops say? Sell it to the judge. So there's no concern at all about what their tactics then inflict on the community that the community then must carry home and deal with. There is no care for our community. So the Public Safety Committee has failed us. The Citizens Action Committee has failed us. The community benefit agreement doesn't cover us. And when you say to people, this can't just be, you know, a fluke. This can't just be a one-time. It's consistent. It's ramping up. So therefore, there is a plan of action here that some people are going to be treated like this until they either die from a short lifespan,
yeah,
or they just get out. I would get out if I had a son in the city. I would never keep my son in the city knowing that they could not even travel like this. when my daughter had to travel to high school and she had to leave from a further part in the Bronx to travel to 19th Street in Chelsea, I would walk her every morning to the train because I saw these vans, these predators, coming out and questioning our children as they went to school. And I would never want that happening to my daughter. And I'd say, why are they so unmerciful to a certain population of people? It is not by chance. It is by prescription.
They have
this plan.
Let's ask your caller, Randy Short. What did you want to ask Agnes Johnson, Randy?
Sister Agnes Johnson, I had two questions and a one to find out how two groups activists connected to some of the young people that you know. One group is in Chicago, one group is in New York. This is one of Alton's people who's prepared, who understands. I won't go any further. You know exactly what I mean. That's one. And two, a question, or should I say suggestion. The murder of Eric Garner, the assassination of Eric Garner, or the lynching of Eric Garner, leads me, because it's in Brazil, because he had a reputation, whether it was earned or unearned, for selling loose cigarettes. And by the way, within a block of where I'm sitting in my home, they're now beginning, you may see killings like this here in Washington because of the police. Many of them from New York are coming here. And in case you want to know where they go, they're all coming to Washington. Eric Garner, I wonder if the merchants, some of the, I have to say it for what it is, some of the Asian and other merchants who give money to the Fraternal Order of Police or companion groups that support the police, do they give money with the hope or the expectation off the books that people like Mr. Garner can be killed because they're competition? If they're selling things that undercut what's being sold in the stores. Was the store nearby where he was killed? Was this store owner, did they make the call? Who did it? And is there anyone looking at this? Because there's a link in Brazil where they murder black men, women, and children. The store owners pay the police and others to murder people. In the thousands. And I feel like this is what's beginning to happen. And if they got it going in New York, eventually it always goes across the country.
Brother Shortman, you know, we have been talking for close to what, a year and a half now? Maybe 2 years? I don't know if that long. But you and I know, okay, as what happened with Emmett Till, as what happened with the stock system, it's always an underlying hand in the background. Now, I'll let the Benjamin from the Garner family speak. I hope he's going to be on.
He actually he's gonna be on at 7. He just texted me.
But to answer one part of it, what I have followed up in New York City, Brother Short, J.P. Morgan, Barclaycard Capital, United Arab Emirates has given $1 million to upgrade the New York City Police Foundation to supposedly help their surveillance. I believe wholeheartedly follow the money. When I found the dumping of shelters all around our schools here in Highbridge, we followed the money. And that's why the local politicians got so angry at me, because I found the company that was getting the contract from the Department of Homeless Services, and they were supposed to be taking and providing services. And they were literally just taking money, breaking Megan's rule, which says you cannot have sexual predators within 1,000 feet of a school. All these things, it's not the cover on top. You always have to dig underneath and you find where is the money pouring in. And that he gets the service, and that he gets the agenda pushed. Vanessa Gibson here. She is the chair of the Public Safety Committee. She had her first public safety hearing, and we went down to see all what the parents of murdered children, Mr. Hayward, Nicholas Hayward Sr., his son was killed while playing in his own play yard with a toy gun. Many people went down to that hearing, and we had to sit while the killer, Bratton, walked in with his cheap little chart and his lying graphics, which were proven to be a lie. He got to go first, and we had to sit. And at the end of it, because we protested, because we said, this is all farce, she wrote a tweet that I sent to you, I sent you to see, and it says that this is such sad times when people are attempting to disrupt the good things we elected officials and that those people are coming in with self-serving agendas. Right! It's such self-serving agendas that don't kill our children to our children and stop killing us. And again, I don't care about any black news. I don't care how he feels about me or his side of the story. The only thing that matters to me is that he suffers the consequences that come from the decisions he has made, and he has sent his dogs out to me. And we have the power. That's the thing you have to understand. We have the power to disrupt it. We have the power to do research and to connect the dots. Randy, we have our young people that we must pull in. About 6 years ago, I called for an emergency call center. I saw the end of Obama's here elected time, and I said at the end of this, as automatic, as predicted, automatic, they won't let him on air. He said at the end of this, we are going to see the end of the Reconstruction era, where we will not be able to even walk into the city hall offices of some old, and we will be killed and our guns collected. And that is what's happening now. We look at the guys in the so-called militia men, they're terrorists. If we did that, there would be tear gas and the National Guard pulled out yesterday. Here today we see they're building a road to the house that they have taken over. So there's no more rainbows. There's none of that. And right now, we have to save our children. And we can do it. We can do it, but we have to now pull together. We have to stop saying what's not there, what you said, what I said. We better start putting up some walls of protection, because we have nothing to protect us. Nothing.
Thank you, Randy.
You're welcome.
Okay, have a good night.
Good night.
So how about if we bring, okay, Shannon or Julio, who would like to go next?
Well, you spoke about elected officials, and you mentioned several issues there that have to do with politics, and I guess maybe this is a good intro.
So, yeah, because yesterday you were talking about some really good things and the corruption and what got you into politics. So start with that.
Yeah, but before I start with that, I just want to congratulate, you know, both ladies who have been on before me, because, you know, this is the thing that basically, you know, motivate me to want to do what I want to do. Because one of the issues that I believe we have in the Bronx, and I'm talking in particular about the South Bronx. When people talk about the Bronx, you're talking about an entire borough. When you talk about the South Bronx, you're talking about almost a third world country. And it's a big difference between the Bronx, where people see Yankee Stadium, and people look at the Botanical Garden, and you go to Bronx Zoo, and you go to Fordham and Dome Bay and City Island, and then you have the South Bronx. In the South Bronx, in the area of the 17th Council Managing District, which is the district that I basically came to when I was 4 years old in Puerto Rico in 1956, and the area that continues to have one of the worst records in just about every category, from health to unemployment to AIDS to violence to high school dropouts, single parent, you know, female head of household, homelessness, oversaturation of program, 40% vacant lot. I mean, I can go on and on. And it's one of the worst districts, but yet nobody paid attention to this district. When this the woman that basically resigned
when she ran in the special election 10 years ago, there was no big hoopla about, you know, County, which is the organization that basically runs the South Bronx, and runs all of the Bronx. An organization, when we say County, is a democratic organization. And in the Bronx, there is no democracy because basically there's only one. If you're a Republican or you're conservative or you're a Working Families Party or you're a liberal, you basically don't participate in any electoral process here. And that's one of the things that the first, you know, speaker who spoke mentioned, that when you ask the question about electoral politics, you can't stay out of it. Because if you stay out of it, basically these scoundrels, and these are the people who basically are in office, they have the power to legislate, and legislation is the law, whether you like it or not. That's the law. And if you don't have any changes in the law, you can't make major changes. In fact, the civil rights movement, there were a lot of demonstrations, there were a lot of sit-ins, there was a lot of forums. But if you look at the history of the civil rights movement, what changed it the most was when they took it to court. When the NAACP and other organizations got together and were able to take a lot of these cases to court, legislation was passed that was able to expedite and hurry in with the period of ending segregation and ending discrimination in many ways, even though we have them in many ways now in a different way, but at least by the law, that you can no longer have people sit in one area of a counter or a bus or not be able to go to a certain school, certain laws were passed. So legislation is very important for us to be able to move our agendas forward. And one of the things that I've seen is that in the South Bronx, a lot of those agendas have been hijacked. You know, people think that there's democracy, but we don't have democracy here. You basically have Game of Thrones here. You have, you know, fiefdom, where families basically run the Bronx. It's father and son, father and daughter, father and son and daughter, father and son. Basically, the names of the families are all there. And it's basically keeping away a lot of other people who might have the experience and might have the interest in getting involved. People just basically gave up. The District 17 is one of the poorest districts, and it also has one of the worst election rates. Very few people vote in this area. We have like 68,000 people. We have 128,000 residents, and almost a little bit less than half are registered. And that has a lot to do because of the Obama campaign and his two runs. He was able to register a lot of people, especially a lot of minorities who want to vote. But a lot of people don't vote. In fact, the numbers that come out in the district usually is like 3,000 or 4,000, and that's a lot. And triple prime voters, which means the people that have come out in the last three primaries of 158,000 people that are registered, only 631 were triple prime voters. And those are all majority women over 55. So there's a huge section of our community that basically does not vote. And I argue that's not a, people say, well, that's apathetic. They're apathetic. They don't want to vote. Well, the reason they don't want to vote, if they walk the streets, they'll notice that the reason people don't vote and don't get involved is because they don't have any faith in the system.
Right.
They don't believe the system is doing anything for them. And you can't blame them.
Right.
I've been walking the streets. I have to collect petitions. Today was the last day. Today we have to file our petitions. And thank God, you know, we've collected enough petitions so that we give them to our attorney so that we get put on the ballot. But in this county, if you run against county, they're going to have about 30 volunteers that they train that are going to go within 2 or 3 days after my attorney submits my petition, and they're going to be looking at every single signature that I brought in and find a way to knock me out.
Right.
And that's what they have been doing to people all along. So whenever a person in this borough and in this district in particular or any other part of the South Bronx wants to, you know, humbly, actively, you know, righteously get involved in the process, which is what the Constitution says, you know, democracy, they never get to even be a candidate because they get knocked out the ballot even before they get in. So they never participate. That's how these families continue to control. They thrive on ignorance of the community. They thrive on people not participating.
Talk
and the reason I'm running is because I basically got fed up with it. I'm I'm not a career politician. I'm interested in being a career politician. At my age, I'm 63 years old. I was raised here. I came from an extremely poor family. I was homeless for a while. My mother and my father separated when I was like 7 to 8 years old. I was raised by my father, who was old enough to be my grandfather. So basically, I had to survive on my own in the streets because I didn't want to get involved in things that I was involved in. And as a result, I was able to make it to the point that I was able to be the first one in my family to get a high school diploma, college degree, and eventually went on to get a graduate degree. I basically never left the South Bronx. I had the resources many times to move out. And I always felt that the South Bronx, to me, was what people are finding out now about the Bronx. The Bronx is a beautiful place to be, and has more parks than any other borough. The Bronx is connected to the mainland, so it's always it's above sea level. So I always thought that, if anything, you know, this is a safe place to live. And Sandy proved me correct. Well, after Sandy, the number of people that wanted to get apartments and get houses in the Bronx, I mean, it just skyped up tremendously. Mm-hmm. Because the Bronx is one of the only boroughs that was not affected.
Mm-hmm.
The Bronx is connected to the mainland. It has great thoroughfares. So from here, you can get to New Jersey, Connecticut, and any other part of the country. You can leave faster. Yeah. So, I mean, it has great infrastructure.
Better than Brooklyn.
Brooklyn, you know, if Godzilla was to come out of Coney Island, Brooklyn people are in trouble. They're the last ones to be able to make it into the mainland.
But when you're in Brooklyn, and if you try to get, you know, leave the city to go, like, upstate, just
you're
trying
trouble,
to get
right?
through Manhattan and the rest of Brooklyn, and forget it, it's like, by the
those are a lot of the features that I always loved about the Bronx, and the fact that the Bronx has a very progressive background, has a very progressive history, which I won't go into now because we got limited time, but basically, I just like the Bronx, I love the Bronx. I was a young lawyer when I was like 17 years old, and that was an organization that the Black Panthers worked in the Black community. The Young Lords were for the Puerto Rican community, and I was able to get involved through that, and that kept me off the streets for a while. The school systems we had then were, you know, able to be open until 5 o'clock. That also helped people stay off the streets for a while. And there were actually a lot of programs. There were, you know, there were Black associations. There were tenant associations. There were programs that allowed a guy like me to be able to go to college and not have to pay a tuition. There was a program called SEEK.
Yeah.
That was able to pay my tuition. And then when I was able to, my second year in college, I had my second child. I was a young parent. It was easier to get drugs and than learn about sexual education or condom. And as a young person, I became a young parent. And I wanted to leave school because I wanted to make more money to survive, to be able to take care of my two daughters and my wife. And my counselor told me, no, you can't drop out. There's very few, you know, Puerto Ricans in school, there are very few people of color. You got to stay here. And she found me a scholarship that existed in the South Bronx for anyone of color who lives here, who was in college. They actually paid me $500 a month to stay in school. Now, I asked you this question. If that happened to me back in the 70s, where I was able to go to school, get a scholarship, not to pay tuition, graduate, and they paid me to be able to stay in school, and I was able to get my degree, and I don't owe a dime. How come today these young people, in order for them to get an education, to better themselves, to provide something for the society, leave college having a major loan? Something is wrong with that picture, because things should be getting better for our children, not worse. How come I had some benefits that they don't have today? We have much more money. We have a lot more resources. We have a lot more technology. We have a lot of things that, you know, we didn't have when I was growing up. But yet, for some reason, as bad as things were for me, they weren't as bad as they are for young people today.
Yeah.
I didn't have to worry about, you know, like what these young people today. The age is going down in all over the country because it's increasing in the South Bronx. You know, you have situations with a prison industrial conflict
right. That
was perfectly laid out prior to my me coming on to speak. That's real. Folks, that's real. That's a prison industrial complex. It's a business.
Right, right.
And when a business, I run two small businesses and one a part-time business that I have. And I'm saying the purpose of a business is to make money. If you're not making money, then you don't have a business. And the prison systems are now a business. And it pays to have the crop. You need to have prisoners. If you don't have prisoners, you basically don't have a business.
So what do you?
And I would say that more than 80% of the people in prison are there for non-violent offense.
What
if
do you?
You want to incarcerate somebody? Incarcerate somebody that's trying to shoot somebody. Incarcerate somebody that's trying to stab somebody. Somebody that took something forcefully from somebody.
Incarcerate a banker. Incarcerate the banker.
Incarcerate the people who really have done real harm to people. A banker does not do harm, but when a banker makes a decision that takes away the pension of hard-working people that work 20, 30 years to have a pension, and because bankers took that money and used it and invested it and created a downturn in the economy the way they did. And they didn't lose any money, but the people who invested in those pensions did, those people should go to jail. That's more violent.
The head of Exxon should be in jail for covering up all they've known about the harm that they've been doing to the environment since the 70s.
Yes. You know, Goldman Sachs was recently, they were recently fined $2 billion.
Yeah, it's a joke.
For their subprime, venture. And the fact is, $2 billion, well, to them, that's nothing.
And but where does it go? People? Where does the money go? Who gets all that money? Not the people that got screwed.
Yeah, and that's why, today, when people talk about, corporate welfare, I mean, if you look at the amount of money that the government has given to banks and to, financial institutions, who's really getting our wealth in this country? It's the corporation, the people in the community throughout this country, and in particular in my area, has the highest unemployment rate. But let me just tell you one of the other reasons why I'm running. I'm running because at my age, I felt that I'm basically the best candidate, not because of my experience that I do have. Like, back in my education, I've worked for the federal government, I worked for the city government, I worked for the state government, so I have all levels of government. I have good contacts. I have a video on my website. Go to it, www.juliopabon.com. You see the 32nd Secretary of Labor, African-American woman by the name of Alexis Herman, who is Secretary of Labor. And look what she says about me. So I have experience in being able to handle some of the things that happen. But the real reason that the county, the Democratic organization, is going all out of their ways to stop my candidacy, none of the other candidates, but mine in particular, is because I am the candidate that has no loyalty to their organization or no one. My loyalties are to my community. And I've been proving that since I've been a 17-year-old young lawyer. I've been working in issues in this community that still are around. And I was involved in, not as a politician, not seeking a vote, not trying to cut a ribbon and be on the front page of the newspaper, but because these were the right things to do for my community. Here's a perfect example. This morning, at 10 o'clock in the morning, in one of the projects, right here, NYCHA project, there was the chairperson of the NYCHA houses, Shola Olatori, and she was there, and she was having a press conference to talk about security measures for the project. I know about that because I've been going into the project to collect petitions, and I hear and I see and I smell, the problems in these housing authority projects. So I was very curious, and I went there. Would you believe there was not one elected official there? Would you believe even worse? There was not even one candidate. There's about seven candidates that want to run for this city council position. There was not one candidate. I was the only guy there. I was there with a handful of, in the cold weather, I was there with a handful of tenants. Listening to this woman come and have every single newspaper and every single TV outlet there, watching her in the cold make up the statement about how these new cameras are going to be installed, and she showed the cameras and she took a little tour. You know, I was the only one that was there. I walked up to her and I said to her, listen, my name is Julio Pabon. I am a candidate for city council. I don't know if you know, there's a special election. It's never about us running, but I want you to know I'm going to win. And when I win, I'm going to call you because I want to talk to you about what you just said about the security cameras, because I've been in this community since 1950 and I've seen many press conferences. But you know what happens after 8 or 9 months when those programs, when those cameras are broken or they're stolen or they don't stop working? Where is NYCHA? Where is the press conference to talk about that? So I told her, I don't want to talk to that about now, but you know what? I look forward to getting elected, and I look forward to calling your office, and I look forward to sitting down with you and talking to you and your staff about how we can sustain these changes that you want to make that will help improve the lives of the people here. A couple of the tenants saw me there, and they had seen me before, some of them, because I had been to those parties to collect the fish. And one of them came up to me, and he said to me, you know what, it's interesting, and you're the only person that came and you spoke to this woman. And I said, yeah, because I know the problems that are happening. I've been here all my life. And she said to me, you know what? I want you to take my number down, because on election day, I want you to call me to remind me to go vote for you.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. That woman probably would have not voted in February. It's probably going to be as cold as it is now to try to get people to come out. But when you go and you talk to people and you explain to people that there is hope because there is a possible solution by bringing people together, which is what I want to do. My answers to the problems in the South Bronx are not going to be resolved with my candidacy. I'll be lying to people if I was to tell them that I have a magic wand and I'm going to get elected and I'm going to make sure I solve all the problems in the South Bronx and the 17th District. That's a lie.
The people got to really, the people have to be involved. You have to really be involved with the community.
Exactly. And that's the difference. I will involve people. My office is not going to close at 5 o'clock like these people's offices.
Right.
These elected officials, all their offices close at 5 o'clock. This is not a business. Being an elected official is not a business. It is a public service. So therefore, those offices should be open later. But it's not just so that people can come and complain about a problem they haven't even resolved it for. Unfortunately, I'm not going to do that for some people if that's what they're looking for. I'm not going to resolve anybody's problems. But I will hook them up with organizers that will help teach them how to resolve their own problem. Because if you give people a fish, they'll eat for one day. If you teach them to fish, they'll eat forever. I want to teach my community how to fish. I want to teach my community how to organize. If you go back to the days when I was a kid and there were people and programs out there for me, there was a lot more organization than we have now in 2016. That's why I'm running.
Yeah, it's no different than being a parent. I mean, it's all about, you know, raising people, right, taking the time. But, you know, today, like, you know, too many people in positions of leadership, all they care about is money and making money at the expense of things that have any real value.
And you know what's worse with that? That these people get elected. If you look at the history,
Benjamin Lawton, the cousin of Eric Garner. He's kind of been standing by, so let me add him to the conversation. But then we'll go to Shannon after you, Julio.
Hello,
Benjamin.
Yeah.
Benjamin Lawton, you're the cousin of Eric Garner.
Yes, I am.
The victim of the infamous chokehold video of Daniel Pantaleo of the NYPD. But if you wouldn't mind just like standing by, because we're gonna go to Shannon Jones of Why Accountability, who's also with us. And then we'll get to you, Benjamin. So,
okay.
Shannon, I wanted to just mention that wonderful, epic video that, I mean, I hope it went viral, I took one video of you, and I know that there are others, during the Tamir Rice march in Brooklyn from the Barclays Center down to the Wyckoff houses where Nicholas Hayward Jr. was also killed by police playing with a toy gun. And you had noticed a couple of cops like smiling or laughing or something, and you kind of went off sort of, you know, on them. And when you told them, you know, go do vertical patrols at One Police Plaza and Wall Street, that was really, it was epic. I can't think of a better word. Tell us why accountability is, Shannon. She maybe went to, okay, so Julio, did you have any last things that you wanted to say, perhaps?
Absolutely. I just want to say that the fact that, you know, our youth, which is my main concern, there's so much talent in South Bronx. I mean, look at the history. Look how these billion-dollar businesses have developed because of what the South Bronx is. When there were gangs, supposedly, those gangs were nothing but, you know, ways for young people to gather themselves and to feel like they had something that kept them together. And they developed a style of dress. It's called, you know, urban wear. None of them made any money from that. Those young kids who didn't have nothing to do and were going to a community room and scratching records, they came up and they developed, you know, rap. And they developed, you know, the urban music right. that we're hearing today. That's a billion-dollar industry.
Yeah.
That $1 has come back to the South Bronx. You know, graffiti. A lot of these kids who didn't have no way to express themselves, they would go out and with paint cans, they'll paint on subways. That was art, form of art. Now it's a form of multi-million-dollar, billion-dollar art around the world.
Right.
Very few people, except for tattoos, thank God, that they're from my community, they're still here. I'm making any money from it. So I'm saying that only to tell you that there's a lot of talent in places like the South Bronx, because you know something that happened to me? When you're poor, you become very creative.
Exactly.
There's a lot of creativity here. And I want to be able to develop programs and develop organizations, come here and help young people develop their own businesses, develop their own ideas.
Yeah.
We don't have to depend on the government to be able to help us survive.
We need to redefine poverty. Shannon.
Hey guys, this is Shannon. Hi. I had the entire program on mute while I was listening, and I'm so sorry, Mr. Pabon, to jump in on the valuable thing that you're saying and the other guests have been saying. But the reason why I'm interjecting is I have to walk away from my phone for a moment. And Mr. Pabon, you touched on some things about meeting the NYCHA chairman, Shola Olatoye, from NYCHA. And I actually live in a NYCHA development. And I'm saying this for the value of your listeners. And as we're talking about issues that plague the South Bronx, trying to link it in with the legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., let me make it known to the listeners out there, I participated in this phone call, and I don't even have heat in my apartment.
Oh,
and I put the phone down. I literally put the phone down as you were talking about questioning Chairperson Olatoye about meeting with her once you're elected. Now, I didn't hear what you said after that because I got a knock on my door from NYCHA Boiler Repair Emergency Services, and you know, they treat the NYCHA residents very disrespectfully. And I won't get into my personal situation. I'm going to pull it back out to what we've been speaking about. The legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is about equality and justice for all people. And we've seen the injustices plaguing black and brown people in the following ways. Through police brutality, murder, and terror. Redlining, discrimination, and in my specific case, inadequate housing conditions. And the purpose of me being on the phone call tonight is not only to discuss what most of us already recognize as the problem, but there must be now a call to action. We have a lot of phone calls, a lot of programs, a lot of panel discussions, a lot of meetings. But what are we requesting our collective, our body of people to do in response to what we know is inequality and injustice in whatever area we see it in? Imbalance in education, the prison industrial complex, mass incarceration, the war on drugs. Take your pick. Anyone can take a pick. Find your passion. But I'm saying this as a call to action to everyone in our listening voice. Don't leave it up to a selected few to think that things are getting done. As Ms. Danette said, one person is not enough. 100 is not enough. If you're unemployed, if you're on parole, if you're on welfare, if you're working class, if you're a single parent, if you are retired, we need you.
Right.
Even if you think you cannot make a difference, you can make a difference. I'm on this radio program to pull like-minded individuals to apply pressure for action. okay? When Martin Luther King organized with the SNCC and other groups and colleges to go to Woolworth counter to invade the lunch counter and do these sit-ins, these were college students. He needed every single person to get these things done, to boycott the bus system, to do marches. At the time of his death, he was fighting for union workers, and, for sanitation workers.
Yeah.
Listen, you need every single person. Don't see Mr. Pabon get elected and think your job is done. The job is not done. Mr. Pabon is going to need assistance from every single one of us. And that's the way it's supposed to go. And the mind control media, well, I'm sorry.
Can I suggest something?
Oh, that's
true. Yeah, and,
okay.
I agree
with you. Hey, Ben, how you doing?
I'm doing okay. So let me say this. It's like Martin Luther King, when he marched, he marched for civil rights. And basically, we have civil rights. We can sue. But what does that do? I mean, at the end of the day, when they killed my cousin Eric, yeah, the family was able to sue. My aunt sued. But $5 million, what is that? That's nothing compared to a lot.
See,
what
we
really doing more
than all of that.
Exactly. What's way more than cash? What we need.
There was a revolutionary by the name of Nevada who said that a human life is worth more than all the riches of the richest man on earth.
Who said that, Julio?
And I've spoken to Ms. Carr on numerous occasions. And see, the responsibility is with the people. The responsibility is with the people.
Exactly.
The people did not apply the pressure on July 19th to 2014, the day after that video was exposed by Randy Order to the New York Daily News. The people did not apply continuous and relentless pressure, what I like to call sustained indignation, to police murder until Daniel Pantaleo was arrested and indicted. We go all the way to December 3rd. That man should have been fired. I'm a city employee, and I'm telling you right now, as a city employee, anybody can walk up to me and fire me tomorrow. It's up to you getting to fight for my job back. But this BS about waiting for a federal investigation is complete BS. And the people of color of the city of New York, and this is a call to action. It's not up to Letitia James. It's not up to Vanessa Gibson. It's not up to these phony politicians to push our sustained resistance. And that's where we failed. No black person should have went to work until that man was arrested.
Amen.
No black person should have bought a goddamn thing
from the store until
he was arrested. If it wasn't food or toilet paper, we shouldn't have bought a goddamn thing.
Shannon.
And that's where it is. Where's the problem?
One at a time.
I just want to say one thing. Shannon, I everything you're saying, I swear to God, I've been saying since the 70s. I mean, for me, it always came down to fitness. Americans, and I don't know about anybody else, but people are not fit. I always knew that. People have been so conditioned to believe that money solves all problems that they lost their fitness. People have lost their goddamn fitness because they think money, this fake thing that man makes, which has no value, it has the opposite of value, it's created out of debt, and it actually perpetuates debt. I hope people hear that. If that's like one thing that people could get through their heads, money is counterfeit. It's not real.
And let me tell you something. I just want to say two things that are very important to say.
You're,
1995, Anthony Bias, was playing football within the Philadelphia front. And football, hit a police car, police officer in the boulder, on that young man and killed him. I was involved in that issue. That was 1995. They were doing that.
So then mm-hmm. what happened between 1995 and 2014, 2015? And that's why what you're saying about sustained organization is important, because Martin Luther King said, mm-hmm. if you don't stand up for something, you're going to fall for anything.
Right.
And that's
and we've been falling ever since.
And that's
we've
the parallel.
That's mm-hmm. why I want to
You got me. Anthony Byers chokehold, Eric Garner chokehold. You got Eleanor Bumpus, mental health. Muhammad Ba, mental health. It's the same parallels, and the community does not pass that test. I call it the blue book. Remember when we were in school and you took a big, big test and it was in a blue book? We are not filling the answers out in that blue book every time we get tested by this governmental authority. Because, and I'm going to advance a radical point, because this is radical here compared to what's going on out here. When you have integration, because we're talking about MLK, because that's part of some of the criticism. Some people may contend then and have contended up until today that integration was a mistake because it has people of color so marginalized. There are black people living in the United States that have never, 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 ever felt racial discrimination. Ever. Ever.
Yeah.
Growing up in the suburbs, being second or third generation college graduate, they have never, ever felt it. So they don't even know what their own people are talking about. And they subscribe to and want to be beneficiaries of white supremacy. So when it's time for us to pull together, we are marginalized.
But I'll take it a step further. You don't have to go upstate New York. I was a teacher in 1975, and I quit after 2 years because the textbooks that they were using were still talking about Indians who were scalping, and I was telling the kids, where did they learn how to scalp? Indians didn't scalp. It was white men that scalped, so they can prove that they killed an Indian. They were getting found for every Indian they killed. Mm-hmm. They were still talking about segregation the way that wasn't. So if you don't have to go that far. When you have schools right here in our own hood, I've spoken to kids, and I've asked them about Malcolm X. And they said, Malcolm who? I'm sitting there, Malcolm who? And I said, this is right here in the ghetto. I mean, it's like, that's why my
I want to give your name.
See, that's the reason why it's incumbent upon us.
I want to give your name. You left out a name. Now, Baez's killer did go to jail. But remember also the name of Johnny Damage. He was a friend of mine. And we did everything that she's been doing for the last, I don't know how many years. The same thing. The making of a movie, the marching, the looking for a special prosecutor, the writing of laws. We did the same thing. I want to just throw in two things too. You spoke about graffiti here in the Bronx. What is one of the groups that Bratton wanted to go after? He wanted to go after graffiti artists as soon as he got in. So he came in with an agenda. And finally, the voting. Look at the musical chairs. Not just families. We don't have a person of a community board chair here in Highbridge. We didn't have an assembly person. When Vanessa left her job to come down and take Helen Foster's job, and Helen Foster decided to quit midterm and go to HUD in Albany. So they play us. They play us. Don't give Vanessa no out. Don't give none of them no out. They put down the yellow brick road to Bratton, and they should have stood up and turned their back on him. But they didn't do it. So don't give them no out.
Absolutely. And that's why one of the radical things I'm saying is and one of the things that I agree with Bernie Sanders is we need to have a political revolution. And that's what I'm bringing out here. Because my office is not going to be an office that's going to be about serving. My office is going to be about organizing. I want to be able to help organize every one of the organizations that we have.
Oh, wait, there's too much noise.
That's another problem.
Wait, Julio.
Going up in the city, if there's a problem in Brooklyn, if there's a problem in the West Bronx, don't tell me that I can't get involved. If I'm a city council person, my face is going to be there supporting it. Because like you said, when these guys, something is happening, and people just sit back and watch and wait, and they're going to put it on their Facebook, and they think that that's organizing, or they're going to put a picture and put it on their Instagram and think that that's organizing. That is not organizing people. That is just social media.
Mm-hmm.
It's just keeping us
in. That's all that is.
That's what we're doing.
People need good old-fashioned fitness. People need fitness. Right. They need to get in their bodies. They need to get out and exercise. And
exactly.
You know, exercise mm-hmm. their rights, and you know that's just it. We're getting away from, you know, for me, everything was always about health and fitness. We're getting away from the way nature works. We need to get just, you know, connected to nature, connect to your body. Forget all this technology stuff. Exactly, all this clicking and clicking on things isn't going to change anything. You know. Let Benjamin speak. Benjamin, talk about your cousin Eric and what happened. And
I remember from the day one when I was out there with the protest movement, and I'm always active in it as well. But it was very few people that came out. There was very few. We had maybe at most 40 people. There were some times where we had over 100 people, but you know what? We need more. So to make a statement, to make them, let them know who we are and how we feel about what these police are doing in their city, they're not just doing it in their city. What happened when my cousin was killed was that systematically across the country, 17 other people in a matter of 1 month period were murdered. Unarmed black people, male and female, old and young. So at the end of the day, it's not a black or white thing. It's a police against a civilian thing right now. These police are out of control. And like, they look at black people and feel that black people do not have any rights. Because at the end of the day, we do not have human rights. We have civil rights. Now Martin Luther King, he marched, he made 13-year march.
I don't see black people from New York City going down to LIE and joining Long Island Police Department and waging this kind of terror on the white people on Long Island. Like, they get to go out here and become employed at the New York City Police Department and wage war in the stratified urban centers of the city of New York. You don't see it. You don't see it. So I get that you're going to be able to pick apart and find some Caucasian individuals nationwide that have been victims of police terror. But by and large, it is happening to the African in America. That is who it is happening to. White people make them more comfortable. Wait, they make them more comfortable with us saying.
Right now.
They make them more comfortable with us saying that it's a civilian thing versus police, or it's a human thing versus police. No, it is the African in America that is being mishandled and terrorized in this country by and large by the minions and pit bulls of white supremacy, which is the fraternal order of police. Let's keep it funky, because what happens is our mission and our struggle.
Let me finish my statement, sister. You said the same thing I just said, but you said it differently. Okay, the bottom line is that we need to, like Julio said, we need to organize. We need to become united. All the organizations that are doing their own little protest here and protest there, they need to all come together. We need to have a focused strategy in order to attack this problem.
But now I'm gonna add this in about the organizations needing to come together. I'm gonna be clear on this. Since we're talking about master plans, the unseen hand, people that are really not interested or invested in communities or people of color. The same way we're talking about that manifesting in housing, in education, in healthcare, in mass incarceration, in policing, trust and believe that same unseen hand operates in social justice. And there are organizations in place social justice organizations that are in place, that are operating not for the building of communities. They are operating also at the marionette string of the same governmental authority that abuses us. Okay?
Right?
I'm talking about organizations created by design to undermine the collective unity of the people. They are created to undermine the collective unity. When Communities United for Police Reform, CPR, can send an email to the mayor's office for its approval before they issue a statement on police brutality, they are not interested in police reform at all. They are not interested in the galvanization of a community. That's a social justice organization actively invested in undermining black people unifying. If you're sending the email to the mayor's office before you release it. So that ain't an infiltrator. That's not an infiltrator. When you have an organization called the Gathering Inc., which has an offshoot called the Justice League, where they send emails to the mayor's office, but then pre-plan their protest and use the mass mind control media to pre-plan protests, that is an undermining of our mission. That's an undermining of our galvanization. But to Joe Schmo watching TV at home, they think work is being done. And it's time for us. Now, we 18 months in since the chokehold death of your cousin, which, by the way, I always say, Ben, and I love you. I would not have been in this movement if it wasn't for you and your family. This is what got me off on my behind. Why accountability was born after the chokehold death of Eric Garner captured on video. This is the reason why I'm outside. Period. But 18 months
You also have institutions inside the government that you have to be careful of, because the same thing is basically let off steam. Because as the community continues to get pissed off and get angry, say something. One of the best things that's happened in this campaign is that I've been able to go into so many NYCHA buildings. Most of my petitions came, most of my signatures have come from the NYCHA buildings. I have not gone to homes, a few homes, and because I'm going to waste time going to an apartment and knocking. I'd rather go to a building that's 21 floors, and I walk the entire building. I've done it. And let me tell you something. One of the most startling experiences that I've had is when people invite me to their homes. Like yesterday, I went to Ellen Briggs' home, apartment 21C. And when I went to her apartment yesterday with her husband, who suffered from cancer, she was telling me, come on in. And I went inside. And she was standing on the phone like you, trying to call. She had no heat. She had no heat yesterday. And I was there with her. She had her oven on. And it reminded me of when I was living across the street on Caldwell Avenue. But then they have set up these committees, they set up these organizations supposedly to help people. So how come the same problem continues to exist for so long? What's the problem? Where's all this money that came down? Police advocacy. Oh, a department is set up so that regular folks, you have a problem with the police department, you can file a complaint. Well, has anybody checked when was the last time that the public advocate for the police department has actually, criticized or come out and chastised a police officer? Those complaints don't get anywhere. My son was arrested on 161st Street. He was going to buy a sandwich. And my son was arrested for 24 hours. He wasn't even given a chance to make a phone call. So when we're talking about discrimination, when we're talking about, rights, the fact that a person, we have a right to make a phone call. You know what that did to my ex-wife, his mother? She almost had a heart attack when she didn't know where her son, who left the door open and left the TV on, was. Nobody knew. 3 o'clock in the morning. He left at 4 o'clock. At 12 o'clock to buy a sandwich. And where was his right? That's all these people listen. Where were we? You criticize Russia? You criticize China? You criticize all these other countries? I'm living in them. You didn't give my son a right to make a phone call. And they said, oh, it was kind of busy. I mean, this is incredible, Rick. So this is the art It's like something that you don't, you know, for a father, for me, to go with a flashlight, to go through my roof, to go through my basement, to think that maybe my son was flowing over from one part of the building to the other because they're all connected and he fell, or maybe that somebody came in and killed him. That feeling of a parent to know that you don't know where your son is at for 14, 15 hours. You're calling priests. I mean, you're calling hospitals to see if they brought in a body that looked like him. I mean, that didn't happen to me in China. That didn't happen to me in Russia. It happened to me in the South Front. A Wesleyan graduate who had come to my house, who's living with me until we get to dress together, and he walked and he gets arrested. When my son won that case, he literally split out of the box. He's living in California. He doesn't want to live in
New York.
That's what we're still going through.
I
agree with you. I don't even have to be. It's not about infiltrating. It's about the government setting up institutions and these other folks freeing up money for programs to come up and set up in our community. And we need to find out. Follow the money.
Exactly.
I wanted to bring up
what I said about the money to the police foundation. Coming from J.P. Morgan, the Arab Emirates. We know also on Elden Week, 2 years ago, they had a major meeting of 30 churches from the Bronx. And they were all coming together. And I told you, I mean, I stood up there alone and said, what do you mean you're getting their money from Homeland Security to then take the parolees that were coming out and the parolees to either decide to become work in pastoral services, that means work at individual church, or work as cooks for Homeland Security. So that's out in your face. We know this is happening. And one other thing I want to say, at the UN in November, there was a big gathering asking about confronting the silence. And I stood up and said, why didn't people stand with us in December of 2013 when we heard the word Bratton said? Before Benjamin, before your cousin was killed, December 13th, January 1st, we stood across the street from City Hall in the freezing cold to hold those banners and look at all the stolen lives and to say no to Bratton. But everybody wanted to be so, oh, let's not be offensive, let's give him a chance. No, you don't give a murderer another chance. And that's what they did. And so now we have the history. The history holds us up. But follow the money. Follow
absolutely
the money.
And Ben, you said something that was very interesting, and I'm constantly talking about this. You know, a handful of people, there should have been so many people going out to where your cousin was killed. There should have been so many people. There should have been so many people, like you say, and like was also mentioned, like people should not have gotten to work next day. People should have been outraged. It should have been a day of outrage, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know what?
I do commend New York City on this one note. Because when we watched on Washington,
no, but listen, you know what the outrage was? I saw it. There were only a handful of people that went out there, but there were thousands of people commenting on Facebook.
Yeah, there were
thousands of people commenting this on Twitter. And the problem is, and this is exactly what the previous person said, that's so important. It's when they co-opt the movement. They've co-opted it to the point that people actually feel that they're doing something. They're organizing by sending out a picture or retweeting or a thing about Eric Garner. I saw his picture in so many places. I saw that video in so many places. But what did it do? It just made somebody feel good that they did something because they passed it on to somebody else. That's ridiculous, man.
Can you guys hear me?
What people realize is that when you allow the TV and the media to bombard your life and make you want to buy all of this nonsense stuff, I mean, all this technology is coming out to keep you locked in your home, and you're locking yourself in. We need people to come outside of their homes and come out on the street and voice their opinions to collectively. But people want to get on social media and think that they're helping the movement.
Right.
Okay, you're making it viral. People overseas can see what's going on. But at the end of the day, we still need your bodies. We still need your voice.
Mm-hmm.
We need you out on the street so that they can see that everybody is outraged. You think they're paying social media that much attention? If you're stuck in your house on social media, they don't have to worry about you. They know exactly where you are. those devices, these telephones that we have, those are low jack in itself.
Benjamin, you know what I'm on the train home? Benjamin, that
when man, the young man, I don't care.
They gotta decide they don't care about the low jack. I don't care about the low jack. I know it's the, I already know this. The government knows I'm at home right now. The government knows when I'm at an unpermitted protest. But when are 5,000 people gonna decide they don't care if the government knows they're at an unpermitted protest?
Yeah.
Okay. You got the mass control media out here trying to make New Yorkers think that everything is okay.
Benjamin, remember that young man that sat next to me on the train when we traveled home?
Yeah.
He was Agnes Johnson.
Yeah.
Remember he had such misinformation about your family.
Yes, he did.
And that's why I take over the trains and the buses, because that's when we can talk to each other. When you got off, do you know he jumped up out of his seat and took his hat off. You know that this government killed Martin Luther King Jr. He jumped out of his seat. He could not believe it. He said, I am going home right now to look that up. And he started asking people, did you know that? Did you? This is how we have to excite them. And we have to organize from the
outreach, direct outreach.
Wow.
Correct,
because
Agnes.
The ones already hooked in, they're done. They're selling out. They're taking the paycheck. They're getting their little cheese or whatever.
I don't live in NYCHA,
and I don't care. They got my picture ready. I'm in books already. Okay, I'm in that famous book. Kelly kept the file on me. The enemy's within, so they know. I take my battery out of my phone every now and then and put it in the freezer, so they don't know where I am. But when I post on Facebook, people gotta understand I'm just sharing the information.
Okay.
So I'm moving somewhere while I'm posting, but I'm always working. We gotta get those that are sitting on the train. That young man told us the cop had handcuffed him, took him to a back alley somewhere, and beat the crap out of him. That's what they did
while he was cuffed.
While we were talking, he never did a thing about it.
Can you guys hear me?
This conversation is very good, but I have to leave because I'm expected to be somewhere else in this meeting. I want to thank all of you. I want to thank all of you for allowing me the opportunity, because I know that I'm in a situation sometimes a little bit, you know, like difficult, because everybody's so anti-electoral politics that sometimes I have to try to, especially young people. You know, that they don't want to hear about it. But you know what's so good?
Yeah.
I've had so many young people in the street that told me, yo, my man, I'm not interested. But by the time I get through with them, they've actually allowed me to register. They said, I'm only going to do it for you. I'm going to vote for you.
There is hope.
Thank you all. God bless you all.
Thank you, Julio.
Have a great night, Julio.
And thanks for being here, everybody. I'm there for you. Let them know there's a revolution in the South Bronx, and we need Jedi Knights to take on the evil empire. I don't care where you're from.
That's right. Nice analogy. I like that.
God bless.
Have a good one, man. Bless you too.
I know.
But I don't blame the young people. I don't blame them for saying that shit out of my face. You tricked me once, you tricked me. I don't blame them.
See, but you know what? Like me and you did when we were coming home from the protest, all of us need to do that. We need to be on the train, the buses, out in the street, and vocally expressing this stuff so that the people can get the information. Because if they stuff on their phones and social media, most of the stuff on social media and Facebook is just trash. I mean, I get on those things, and every now and then, you know, I like to have fun. To me, that's just entertainment, leisure. But when you have serious issues, you have to go the extra mile to become an adult. When you become an adult, you got to put away the traits of a babe. That's just it. You have to stand up and do the adult thing. The adult thing is not to be on there talking about how much money Jay-Z got over how much money Puff Daddy got. Come on, that's immaterial stuff. Well, you got police out there killing us. Just looking at us, they're killing us. Come on. We need to get to a point where that we're starting to educate one another to go out and stand firm. Like he was telling people, if the police are handling a suspected person for doing whatever they suspect him to be doing, the people around should stand there and stop their phones and stop videotaping. to make sure. And anyone who knows that in the business should come back and check on that person and make sure that person got to the precinct safe and that he got his due process right, whatever they are. We need to be able to have people to be accountable for their own community. We need to advocate accountability to ourselves. Because if we're not looking into these things ourselves, then how are we expecting the police to be accountable for the stuff they do? The reason why they do the stuff they do is because they think that we don't care about each other.
Can you guys hear me?
We don't get people to...
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, you can hear me. Okay, I thought I was...
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, great. Yeah, I just thought I was having a technical problem over here and that I needed to fix, but yeah. So,
like I was saying, we need to make sure that people understand that in order to make the government accountable, we have to be accountable to it. We have to be accountable for the things we are allowing to happen to us. Because at the end of the day, we are allowing this.
Exactly.
And we needed to have, and like the sister said, we had to have enough people out there. The very next day after this happened to my husband, we should have had more than 100 people out there. It should have been thousands of people out there in front of this to make sure Pennsylvania was there, to make sure those other officers involved was indicted and arrested, to make sure that the EMS workers had been held accountable for not doing their job. At the end of the day, they're back on the job. They're still doing like business as usual. Well, we have to put a stop to that, but we have to be accountable for our own actions. If we don't stand up, then they're going to say this, what they've been saying, that, oh, they don't care. And that's why I post regularly that I wish Black Lives Matter to Black people. Because if Black people don't care about Black people, how would you expect any other nationality to care about us?
We have
to stand up together and say, listen, we matter, and we think you matter too. Let's have the same rights. Let's have the same ability to do things. Let's control our government that we put in place. They say we must vote. If we voted you in, we can vote you out. If you're not going to work for us, we're not putting you there to work for you. We're putting you there to work for us.
What happens? What happens with Rahm Emanuel? Like, I can't understand why, you know, we have to ask Rahm Emanuel to resign. Do they ask us if we want to get arrested, if we, like, jump a turnstile or get in the back of the bus, you know, for a $100 sign or something? I mean, if this guy is, you know, kept that video and the truth about Laquan McDonald's killing under wraps and hidden for over a year, I mean, like, why? I mean, it's ridiculous that it's so hard to hold somebody in power accountable who's a real criminal, as easy as it is for them to put, you know, right, like, just the average person or a kid in jail for nothing.
Well, this is where we talk about Martin Luther King. Everybody loves the nonviolent peace. Everybody loves the free at last peace.
Yeah,
he also spoke about feeling the pain and redistributing the pain.
Mm-hmm.
And we do not redistribute the pain. Like I said, when those Mizu young men said, we ain't playing till this mom's scooter gets funded. And that would cost the campus $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
It would cost the state $25 million. The threat alone cost the school $1 million. They got rid of his ass the next day.
We're not ready to feel the pain.
We have to feel the pain.
Mm-hmm.
We got to feel the pain. Mm-hmm. People in poverty already feel the pain. So really, you know who I'm talking to? I'm talking to Shannon Jones. I'm talking to the Black people that got a little bit of degree, that went to school and got a little degree. I'm talking to the Black people that might make more than $50,000 a year or even make more than $100,000 a year. I'm talking to all them Black fraternities and them Black sororities and that Black elite. They don't want to feel the pain.
No.
They don't want to make the sacrifice to stop buying car rents, fur coats, weave, fancy cell phones, dressing your kids up in $1,000 outfits. They don't want to feel the pain. People in poverty already feel the pain. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking from experience. I already went to school, got the degree, and made the money. Mm-hmm. But that don't stop me from making the sacrifice. And see, that's what integration messed us up with. Because you got too many black people sniffing white supremacy and like the smell. What did I say yesterday? You think you're in the bosom of protection, but you're really in your ass cheeks. They don't feel warm, but you're really getting shitted in your face. And this is what the black elite don't understand. They're not operating with collective self-determination.
Right.
You think you made it because you got it. You shouldn't
and
be
they don't
satisfied.
Want to be seen with you, Shannon. And they don't want
that's
to be
right.
seen on that side of the fence. And it's no doubt when they sit down in the Sada Center, when they sit down the Morales Sada Center at City College, and we all went there to support those students. Shut it down. The administrator just went in there and just shut down the whole building because they were organizing. And what happened? I saw members of the Negro professorship standing but a distance away looking, shaking their head. And I went over. I said, why aren't you standing with the students? They say, we agree the administration was too heavy-handed, but we got to pay our mortgage. They couldn't be seen on camera. Even making that step. And the other thing I want to say to you, brother, it's not just about showing up the day after. It's about a sustained, consistent standing. Don't just come out the day after and then you disappear a week later, because that's what the enemy says. The enemy says, they're going to withstand this. They're going to be gone.
Because we went from 60,000 people. There were 60,000 people out there on December, what was it, December 13th, 2014.
Mm-hmm.
There were 60,000 people on 14th Street.
Mm-hmm.
Mind
that's
you,
right.
That was organized by the mass control media. That's right.
Right.
I ain't even going to go there because we ran out of time. We went from 60,000 people.
We were marching on Washington, they had some people, the 60,000 people in New York City marching, and that I have to commend them. But you know what? At the end of the day, that was only one day. Because while we were in Washington and they were in New York, it stopped after that. We needed
How many times have National Action Network and Al Sharpton dragged people to Washington? Let me tell you something right now, and this is for the listeners. I pray to the ancestors, nothing happened to me, my child, my black son, or anybody in my family. But God forbid anybody that I know that's within arm's reach of my mind and heart, Al Sharpton will not be dragging me or none of my family members to Washington on a Saturday in front of a government office that's closed to beg for shit that they've already proven that they're not going to give you. Period. And that's what we got to stop playing games.
That was a plan. And what did he say to Ferguson? He said to Ferguson, we're going to show you how to do it by that fake little caravan over the bridge to the empty DA office in Staten Island. We're going to show you, Ferguson, how to do it.
I went to that when I was still blind. I went there. I went out there, didn't know no better. Let me tell you, Why Accountability was born August 4th, 2014. That was 2 days, if I'm not mistaken, before Mike Brown laid in the street in the hot sun for 4 hours, deceased in the ground. So we went to that rally on August 26th of 2014. Very excited, very ramped up. But let me tell you, my cherry got popped once I saw the nonsense that National Action Network and these other mass mind control media organizations do to subvert and divert collective self-determination from Africans in America, period. Because there's no way in hell you got a nationally syndicated show or national TV from the white liberal media and you doing something for your own people. The two don't go together. And they keep dragging families to these empty rooms, to these empty courthouses, to these empty spaces to do adult and pony show.
We only have a minute left, folks. We have it's just coming up on 1 minute left. So if everyone would just kind of say their last, you know, like where you can find your information, your websites, and any last sort of brief comment. We'll start with Agnes.
Okay, well, let me give this last brief question.
Oh, okay, Benjamin.
I advocate this. This is Benjamin, yes. I advocate that we continue to build our community by buying black. Buy black. Any black-owned entity, support it. Because we need to put the money back into our community. People say that they weren't willing to go out there and buy all this stuff from these white giants. Buy from the black little people. Make them giants. That's how we gotta do it. We gotta keep the money in our community.
Yep.
We gotta stop buying the trash they put out there. And we gotta support black people. Any venture that's black, support it. Even if it's expensive, you spend money on expensive stuff all the time.
Okay, Agnes is next.
Okay, this is Agnes Johnson. You can find me all over Facebook. I'm with the South Bronx Coalition, as well as New Yorkers Against Bratton, as well as New Yorkers for Black Educational Excellence. I just want to say two sentences. Culture, remember, is not about song and dance. It's not about what you're wearing. Culture is about building for the future, understanding that we build for the future, and phony politicians engage only in a political game that serves to empower the police. That's all they're doing.
And Shannon Jones of Why Accountability.
Okay, Shannon Jones, Why Accountability. We are on Facebook at Why Accountability, WHYACCOUNTABILITY, spelled straight out. No Ebonics. We are also on Instagram at Y_accountability. We are on Twitter at WATweet. You can find us all over the internet, www.yaccountability.com. You may inbox us, or you can email us at info@yaccountability.com. I encourage all Bronxites to attend your local precinct community council meeting and disrupt the NYPD safe space that they have pushing propaganda and misinformation and disrespect about our families and about our children. So everybody keep the faith. We're going to continue to organize. And I thank you, Cat Waters, for this opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you all, and I'll see you again at the next action.
All right. Thanks. Have a good night. Bye, Agnes. I'll see you in the street, Ben.
There you go.
Okay, good night. Okay, so I just want to remind everyone, please go to Awake Radio 1, Awake Radio, the number 1 with no spaces on YouTube for the organic news podcasts, and there's a link to help support. You know, just like they're saying, everyone has to do their part. Everybody has to exercise, put your funds where your beliefs are, fund what you believe in. Don't just assume, someone else is going to do it because nobody's doing it. I literally get zero donations, and I don't know how much longer I'll be able to keep up this radio show. So thank you. Power to the people. Good night.